Welcome to part four of A Very Brief History of Opera. My name is John Andrews, and today we reach the latter part of the 19th century and the apex of high romantic opera. Six of the most popular operas of all time come from this 50-year period, in which the foundations of romantic musical drama laid down in the previous half century, rich chromatic harmonies, dazzling orchestration, and powerful declamatory singing came to maturity with some of the most heartbreaking dramas of all time. Some audiences mourned the loss of the more refined beauty of the past, and during this period the term bel canto, beautiful singing, was coined to refer nostalgically to the previous generation of Rossini, Bellini and Donizetti. But those voices were few and powerless against the popularity of these new operas. The dominance of these works and this period has come to define opera in the modern popular imagination. For good and for ill, this is a period whose social and sexual attitudes are very far from our own, and the widespread characterisation of opera as essentially 19th century and tragic in its aesthetic outlook does a grave disservice to both the preceding centuries and our contemporary art. But that is a price that we seem destined to pay for the overwhelming popularity of these undoubted masterpieces. Before we discuss these titans who dominated the late 19th century stage, we need to step back a couple of decades to a concert that would set in motion a chain of events that would, over the course of the next 100 years, completely revolutionise our attitude to music in opera and concert for good. In 1829, at the Berlin Singakademie, the 20-year-old prodigy Felix Mendelssohn presented a performance, in fact three performances, of J.S. Bach's St. Matthew Passion. Now, this is frequently cited as heralding the rediscovery of Bach's music, but that's actually to miss what was truly life-changing about it. Because up to this point, and until the last years of the 19th century, when we talk about what operas were being composed and what operas were being seen by audiences, we can take it for granted that they were one in the same thing. Or to put it another way, 16th, 17th, 18th and early 19th century theatregoers only ever went to see music that was new, freshly written, usually with the composer not merely alive, but physically present. Even where an opera had a success somewhere in Europe and then was repeated somewhere else several years later, you could expect it to have been revised, sometimes gently, sometimes radically, to bring it right up to date. With the exception of church liturgies and a few antiquarian societies then, such as the Academy of Ancient Music in London, which might perform works that were 20, even 30 years old, all public performances were of new music. So it's really rather missing the point to say that Mendelssohn discovered Bach. Musicians had always known he was there. The point is that while they regarded him as worthy of study, of profound respect and technical emulation, that was not the same as thinking he was suitable for performance to a general public. This idea that you might continue performing the music of the past was Mendelssohn's profound impact on concert life, to the point where we have gone a full 180 degrees and new music is now the exception rather than the rule in our theatres and concert halls. Moreover, Mendelssohn had a profound view that the previous generation to his, and in particular Haydn, Mozart and Beethoven, represented a core of classics, a term borrowed from the revered works of the ancient Greeks and Romans. This is the moment when the idea of a fixed canon really begins to take hold, and its effects over the next 200 years were earth-shattering. This evolution of attitudes, the maintaining of older works in the performing repertoire, the hardening of an idea of what therefore constitutes classical music, and the consequent discrepancy between what was being written and what was being performed will be in the background of our story from now on. But first, to Paris.
Je veux vivre dans ce rêve qui
dominating the Parisian stage in this half century, lyric opera shared much of the scale and sumptuousness of the grand opera of the previous generation, not least the expansive five-act structure and self-contained ballet sequences. But in character and subject matter, these dramas tended to be more intimate and more character-driven, and this is an age of truly great characters in opera. The genre was dominated by Ambroise Thomas, whose undoubted melodic gifts and beautiful orchestration were not always matched by a secure grasp of dramatic flow, and Charles Gounod, whose two greatest works, Faust in 1858 and Romeo and Juliet in 1867, have proved to be perennially popular, with a sure grasp of drama, vivid personalities on stage combined with glorious melodies and sumptuous orchestral textures. At the same time, swinging between acidic satire, heartfelt romanticism and outright farce, Jacques Offenbach offered a new and dazzlingly anarchic way of looking at the world. With his steely gaze fixed on society's foibles, both big and small, he took opera comique and fashioned from it a vehicle through which to express both serious and silly ideas, earning the admiration of both Arthur Sullivan in England and Johann Strauss in Vienna. There is something truly Protean about Offenbach's output. 1 minute creating sumptuous operas that beautifully blend comedy with deep-seated romanticism, and at another turning out delightful one-act farces whose surface silliness often masks a pointed satirical barb, or four or five. At his best, these disparate elements combine in the same work, and it's in this period that people start to draw a distinction between opera, generally now seen as all sung, and operetta, where there are substantial amounts of spoken dialogue. Whilst this may be a reasonably convenient distinction, it's not terribly meaningful, and comic opera, light opera, and operetta can be used pretty interchangeably, and the distinctions rarely offer much illumination of a work's character or quality. Because, as so often in musical history, it's the masterpiece that can't quite be fitted into any category that's enjoyed the greatest posthumous success and has had the most profound influence. Written for Paris's opera comique with spoken dialogue, Bizet's Carmen exploded out of the confines of this genre, combining romantic exoticism, eroticism and psychological darkness together with an extraordinary rhythmic and melodic vitality. Unfortunately, Bizet died shortly after the premiere and never knew the phenomenal scale of its success. It would prove to be a profound influence on the Italian composers at the end of the century in particular, injecting their essentially conservative tradition with a shot of raw energy that firstly reinvigorated Verdi and then profoundly influenced the Verismo composers who followed him into the 20th century. And so we turn to Giuseppe Verdi. He has been described as no less than the whole of Italian opera after Donizetti. And that statement encapsulates two truths. The first is that Puccini, his obvious successor, was as much an heir to Wagner and Bizet as he was to the Italian tradition. But it also recognizes that Verdi's melodic and dramatic flair completely eclipsed both of his older contemporaries, Giovanni Puccini and Saverio Mercadante. Of his 26 operas, two comic and the rest tragic, almost all are still performed today as part of the regular operatic canon. He came into his power alongside Italy's struggle for unification, and his early choruses in particular, imbued as they are with that nascent nationalism that was firing the Italian city-states, contributed in no small measure to his success. But more importantly, his artistic evolution in Italy was slow and solid, in a way that was only really possible within this very conservative environment. He adopted wholesale the structural conventions and sound world of his predecessor Donizetti, and then slowly but surely adapted and transformed them into something very clearly his own. Well into his middle period, he clung to the clear established formal structures of recitative and aria cabaletta, and he continued, as his forebears had done, to tailor roles around specific singers, although he did balk at the continued assumption in Italy that he teach them their arias personally. But in spite of this apparent reliance on fixed formal musical structures, Verdi's ability to pace a scene, to control the flow of drama between characters, has very few rivals. His brilliant delineation of character created some of the most memorable heroes and heroines of the century. Gilda, Violetta, Falstaff, Otello, to name but a tiny fraction. The growth in the size and range of the orchestra in Germany left him largely untouched, and so whilst his sound world is darker and richer than his predecessors, it remains very audibly their child. He also rejected all of the mythology and symbolism and, for the most part, supernatural elements prevalent in romantic plots, and he concentrated on clear human dramas. He came to maturity with a trio of undisputed masterpieces, Rigoletto, La Traviata and Il Trovatore, all of them concise dramas driven by human weaknesses, redeemed by a deep humanity. He then absorbed the grandiosity of the French tradition, culminating in Aida in 1871. There followed an astonishing 16-year hiatus, during which time he composed no new music, but instead absorbed the challenges set to him by the raw visceral power of Bizet's Carmen on the one hand, and the dramaturgical revolution of Wagner on the other. He emerged from this in his 70s to produce two final masterpieces, Otello and Falstaff, and I think there's no coincidence in the fact that they're both Shakespearean adaptations, the consummation of the Italian tragic and comic traditions respectively, bringing a plasticity of melody and form to those old structures before it finally gave way to the new operatic world that had been envisioned by Wagner. And so, to that challenge. It is quite impossible to overstate the influence of Richard Wagner on musical theatre either in the 19th century or indeed the 20th. The literature abounds on Wagner's life, works and influence, and I wouldn't dare to step into any of those debates. Here I can only try to place him within the broader narrative of opera's history. Where Verdi took a tradition and refined it and revived it, Wagner broke it apart in an attempt to start again from the very beginning, because in many ways he is the embodiment of those ideas that had first animated Florentine scholars nearly three centuries before. Indeed, his preferred designation of his works as music dramas rather than operas harks back to that very first Dramma per Musica back in 1597. His aim was nothing less than to restore the idea of opera as the most perfect imaginable synthesis of music and theatre. When we step into a theatre now, it is Wagner's theatre that we step into. The very idea of letting that building and that space absorb us and allow us to immerse ourselves, taking us completely out of the present, is his. A pioneer of electric light, he was the first to dim the house lights to focus the audience's attention on the stage. Most opera houses have been designed for the audience to admire each other as much as the performance. And 17th and 18th century Italian theatres even had curtains in the boxes that could be drawn, rather like turning down the television volume, if the performance ceased to entertain. In his purpose-built opera house at Bayreuth, he even sank the conductor and orchestra out of sight to make the stage the sole focus of attention. The idea of the production, the set and costume being designed specifically to the piece is largely his. Theatres would regularly use stock sets, and singers were still bringing their own costumes to productions elsewhere in Europe well into the 20th century. In short, asking an audience to genuinely maintain suspension of disbelief for the full duration of a performance comes from him. His influence pervades every question that we ask about how we should approach art and music. As a young man in Europe, Wagner naturally absorbed the prevailing operatic traditions. Rienzi in 1835 emerges very much from the world of Meyerbeer's grand operas, whilst The Flying Dutchman in 1843 builds on the ghostly, mythic world of Weber and Marschner. How revolutionary Flying Dutchman is, incidentally, can be gauged by the fact that it shares a date with Donizetti's Don Pasquale. But these two traditions, the ghostly and the grand opera, find a kind of accommodation with one another in his next two operas, Tannhäuser and Lohengrin. His career was then interrupted by the Europe-wide revolutions of 1848-9, and as a young, radical and passionate democrat and nationalist, Wagner found himself exiled to Switzerland. There he begins work not only on his great tetralogy, The Ring, but also several essays, including the artwork of the future. He becomes convinced that music must be the perfect servant of the drama, that opera must fuse together the visual, oral and dramatic arts into something whose power is much more than the sum of its parts. This was the rebirth of the ideals of the Florentine Camerata, but now Wagner had at his disposal modern theatrical technology, the dramatic and emotional resources of an immense symphony orchestra, and perhaps more important than anything else, the most daring and creative approach to harmony yet imagined. He had few, if any, rivals in terms of the rich expressivity of his harmonic palette, and he was able to use dissonance in a way nobody before him had even approached. He also rejected the artificial structures of the aria cabaletta, still present in Italian opera, instead using leading motifs associated with individual characters and places to bring dramatic and musical coherence to his scores, so that his works could be driven entirely by the text and the drama could be in the moment without any imposition by artificial musical structures. This approach was then heightened further in the years after 1848 by his discovery of Schopenhauer. This saw him discarding political radicalism for the transcendental idea of the renunciation of the will and even of physical reality itself. And between these, the challenge that he laid down, both in terms of the integrity of music and drama and the sheer chromatic glory of his harmonic writing and his peerless use of an enormous symphony orchestra, set the challenge for all other composers, both contemporary and to follow. Emotion and sensuality of Wagner's music has continued to divide audiences into the present day and was a profound challenge to the generation of composers coming after him. But the sheer success of Verdi and Wagner in the opera houses, combined with renewed German strength through unification in 1870 and a perceived dominance of German repertoire in the concert halls, was about to provoke a serious backlash from the rest of Europe, and in particular to the East. At the forefront of this new nationalism would be that place where linguistic pride met musical inventiveness. And it was through opera that it first really made its mark. And the challenge of this new set of composers from areas not previously associated with operatic pride and success will be the subject of our next talk.